Journey with Judy.
Honest, open, transparent. It's hot.
There's no such thing as perfect people. There's no such thing as a perfect life. So come as you are, broken and scarred. Lift up your heart and be amazed and be changed by a perfect God.
My strongest feeling right now, if I had to identify it, is gratitude. Just gratitude for who God is and what he does and continues to do in my life and the life of the people that I love. Okay, but here's the deal. Not only am I a total spaz, but I am also the most selfish and self-absorbed person that you'll ever have in your life. It's always about me. And the time that it's most about me is when I'm getting on an airplane, because I am so afraid to fly. But I get high with a little help from my friends. And I finally found this pill that I can take that helps me chill out, if that's even possible. It actually makes me totally fall asleep and not remember anything about the flight, which was a beautiful thing. But anyway, last week I had the privilege of traveling to Florida to watch my daughter play in her club volleyball national championship. And so I was like a freak show day and night before, because of this apprehension that I have of flying. And people are like, well, what's, like, I thought you were a person of faith. And my son always says, like, so what's the worst that happens? You go see God? Who cares? That's what you're supposed to do. But the reality is there's just something about it that really just freaks me out. And so what I do every time before I fly is I totally overbook the week that I'm going to get back. So I was supposed to come home on Sunday. So Monday through today, I had such an incredibly booked schedule of people that I haven't seen in forever, you know, gathering after gathering, commitment after commitment, because I was absolutely sure that my plane was going to crash. And here's the deal. If my plane were to crash, then clearly all of you people who have committed to seeing me this week would certainly have time to mourn my death, talk about how you were supposed to be seeing me this week, but meanwhile, you're at my funeral. So, like, I'm plotting my own death, and I'm trying to actually be in control of that. I promise the flight attendants all of my jewelry if we get there safely. I enter the airplane and go left into the cockpit, even since September 11th they let me in the cockpit. And Bob generally goes right along with whoever's traveling with us and pretends like they don't know us. And I like to talk to the pilot about how confident he is in, you know, the aircraft and the weather and, you know, safe travels. But the bottom line is, once I arrive at my destination, everything changes. Because up to the point that plane touches the ground, I am seeing nothing because I am consumed with myself. I'm not aware of who's around me. I'm not aware of anything other than when that plane touches down. And here's the deal. When the plane touches down, I've been known to sit on the tarmac for 6 hours in complete peacefulness because we are on the ground. So it doesn't bother me where it touches down, just that it touches down when it's supposed to and how it's supposed to, and I'm safe at my destination. So the other thing I've learned is there's no high like the most high. And people say that you just love to fly. No, I hate to fly. But when we finally landed in Orlando, it was time for me to step into who it is that I was supposed to be, like this person of faith and a mother of the girl playing, and just, you know, actually embrace and enjoy this incredible opportunity that my daughter had to play on such a competitive level with people all over the country at 13 years of age. And I see in my daughter the unlimited giftedness that God has placed within her, most often when there's a net in front of her. I don't see those things at home. I don't see those things when we're together. I see them while she is playing volleyball. The other thing that I encountered in the 5 days that Bob and Kennedy and myself were there were players and parents, coaches and refs, drivers and wait staff, the maids and the guests. There was clearly one thing that they all possessed. What was it? I'll tell you when we get back. You are listening to Journey with Judy right here on Lake 96.1. We'll be back.
May.
Mandisa said it, and my dad echoes it. It's a good morning simply because you're on this side of the grass. We left for the break talking about the one thing that every person I encountered on my trip to Orlando, Florida, all the way there and all the way home, the one common thing that they possessed. And what that is that they were all my neighbor. Whether I realized it, whether I acknowledged it, or whether I responded to it, each and every one of those people, simply because by definition they were situated in close proximity to me. They were a fellow human, and they were one that we are commanded, not suggested, commanded to love the way we love ourselves. So we're talking today about what it is to be a neighbor. And I know you've heard this story in scripture about the Good Samaritan. You know what? It's not only a parable. It's so well known that it's actually now a entry in the English dictionary. You can actually make a Good Samaritan phone call, a 911 call on behalf of somebody on the side of the road or with some desire to help them. And that came from scripture, as everything does. And it was about a dude headed from Jerusalem to Jericho. And he was in a ditch and he was down and out. After he was beaten, stripped, and left for dead, I'm considering him to be pretty downtrodden and forgotten. And as he laid there, the people that passed by him were the various representatives of the hierarchical structure of society at that time. So the first dude who walked by this guy laying in the ditch, downtrodden and forgotten, was a priest. Go figure. And he didn't only see him and walk by him, but he walked all the way around him and left him. The next guy who walked by was a Levite, an ordinary Israelite, just like a regular layperson like you or me. He too passed by on the other side. But the Samaritan, he was different. He didn't turn the other cheek and look away. He did not recognize his responsibility, but he was moved with pity, is what the scripture says. Because obviously he knew that his neighbor was everyone. So the story of the Good Samaritan only appears in one gospel, but it basically is calling us to recognize the many faces of our neighbor. It teaches us to answer the question, who's my neighbor? And what is my responsibility? Number one, someone who doesn't respect or understand you, I'm here to tell you they are your neighbor. The person that came to mind when I wrote this show for today was my children. Because I know they don't understand me, and I'm pretty sure many times they don't respect me. Think of somebody in your life who fits into that category, whether it's an individual or a group. We got some enemies. We got some haters. I think the kids call them haters these days. But we gotta love them anyway. In Jesus' day, the Jews, they hated the Samaritans. They didn't just not like them. They were like mortal enemies because they judged them to be inferior politically, ethnically, and religiously. And Samaritans hated the Jews because they felt totally misunderstood, persecuted, and abandoned by them. This guy, the Good Samaritan who recognized his neighbor, he's the hero in the story because he chose to love like Jesus. God calls us to reach out to everyone, including those who have judged you or you have judged, including those who don't understand you or respect you. How about number two? Someone who you don't have any responsibility to help. I have heard it said a million times, I take care of my own, or we take care of our own. And P.S., God died for me and for you. And for every single one of your enemies. He showed no favoritism. It wasn't even factored into the equation. It's so easy to love those who say and do and think what you want them to. This challenge this morning is to love like the Samaritan did. The dude in the ditch, he was a victim. He was a Jew. He was an enemy and he was a stranger. Normally, they wouldn't have given him the time of day if the roles were reversed. The dude in the ditch wouldn't even have looked at the Samaritan. But see, love transcends logic, so it doesn't make sense that this would happen. It would have been easy for him to say, it's not my problem. It is. The thing that we do best as a family is go to the shelter and help people who very easily we could sit in judgment of and say we have no responsibility to help them. Do yourself a favor and go visit the Twin Oaks shelter. You will find you will get more than you will ever give. Number three, someone who is convenient to love, who's inconvenient to love. Thank you. And someone who can't even thank you or pay you back. The Samaritan's plans were totally disrupted, and I've said this a million times, and I'm not even exaggerating. Whenever I am talking to a topic, God says, show me how you do it. Well, I'm here to tell you that you need to take my advice once again because I'm not using it. As I had three people step into my life in the last 24 hours that were inconvenient, that couldn't pay me back, and they probably would never thank me. And it dawned on me as I was riding my bike this morning that I'm not practicing what I'm preaching. And if we're going to be honest, open, and transparent, I got to work on this stuff the same way you do. So this Samaritan guy, he didn't only stop, but he gave. He wasn't part of the problem. He became part of the solution because you're one or the other. Fact. Do we decide who's worthy of our help and who's not? I know I lived the majority of my life discerning who was worthy of my time, talent, and treasure. And it was always based on convenience. Jesus says you're supposed to give without withholding. You're supposed to give without measure because that's the way it's going to be measured back unto you. See, I'm someone who doesn't only want to be thanked, like, publicly, but I want, like, I'm like a martyr. You know, my brother always says, get off the cross. They need the wood. Jeez. The glory is about God being recognized, them seeing God in you. But see, I'm always like, no glory for you, only for me. I want gratification. I want glory. That's my glory story. That's the way I roll. But when you love the way God does, it's possible to do what this good Samaritan did in the story. He knew that he'd never be able to be paid back. The rest of the parable goes on to say that he didn't only take him to an inn after he nursed his wounds and cleaned him up. He took him to an inn and he made sure that there was enough money there so he could stay there as long as he needed to. There was going to be no thanks. There was going to be no rewards. And there certainly wasn't going to be any paybacks. It was just a dude being deliberate and about giving in secret with no strings attached, because that's the message. And I didn't know that. You know, clearly God put obvious limitations on our intelligence, on my intelligence, but none whatsoever on my stupidity. When I was riding my bike the other day, I went over the railroad tracks, and like in 2 seconds, this train was just, all of a sudden, it was right there. I have to be honest, I didn't see it. I didn't even have any headphones on. I didn't see it coming. I didn't see it. I didn't hear it. And I didn't even know it was there until it could have been too late. And I so don't want that for you. So we got to be aware. Who's our neighbor? You are listening to Journey with Judy right here on Lake 96.1. We'll be back.
And every breeze that blows my way, I'll be building my kingdom just to watch it fade away. It's true, that's me without you. Yeah, 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 yeah. Don't know where I'd be.
That's me without you. That's what we're talking about, is being a good Samaritan. It's so hard to do that when we live in a society that talks about who is worthy and who is deserving of our attention and our affection and our time and our talent and our treasure. Because a good Samaritan is just someone who voluntarily offers to help and to be present to somebody else. And who are we supposed to be present to? Our neighbor. And who is our neighbor? Everyone in close proximity. So I'm digging this song where it says I'd be building my kingdom just to watch it fade. I'd be chasing every wind that blows my way. That's me without you, because I could never even see Christ or be Christ without his help. So anyway, we talked about three people that show themselves as neighbors. How about number four? Someone who could harm you, or someone you judge doesn't deserve to be treated with dignity. The Samaritan in this story, he didn't look at the present condition of the dude in the ditch. He looked at his future. He realized that that dude was more than the sum of his past mistakes, or in this case, his circumstances. He didn't focus on his helplessness, but on the help that he could provide. My best example of being ministered to when I thought I was going to be the minister was the privilege of being in the Walworth County Jail and ministering to the women on Mother's Day. It would be obvious that people would be afraid to walk into that scenario. And I'll tell you, when people said, what happened when the door closed behind you, when the jail cell closed? There was something that spoke volumes to me about how those people were loved and valued by God just as much as I was. And that they deserve to be treated with dignity just because. And in many cases, the only difference in those people that were behind bars and me, who came to visit and bring some hope, was that they got caught at what they did. That's it. But they're still our neighbor. How about number five? Someone who is in need of your love when you either, number one, don't feel qualified, number two, don't feel you have the time. Know that you have been placed in their life for a reason. Know that if he puts someone in your path, chances are he wants to use you. There will always be something you can be taught. See, the Good Samaritan didn't just go the ordinary mile, but he took and made the extraordinary sacrifice. There's so much more to this message than we would ever consider. My son has somebody in his life right now, and it's amazing how God has placed them together, because clearly neither one of them feels qualified to be of assistance to the other. And can I tell you, they are empowering and they are strengthening and they are doing things together and for one another, because iron sharpens iron. They're being good Samaritans. And this message is about the kingdom of God, that it knows no political or religious boundaries. There's no way to decide, like, who's in and who's out. There are not insiders and outsiders in the kingdom, because it's so about the power of love over the love of power. It's about loving whether you feel like it or not. It's about loving whether you ever get loved back, whether it's accepted or rejected, because that's the way God loves you. He just loves you, and his love just keeps going and flowing until someone is just willing to receive it. The story in this parable is about moving beyond any social expectation. It's about knowing that everyone must be concerned about everyone and how we treat people, what we do when nobody's looking. Who we are in private is what we're going to be judged on. And it isn't easy. It's not supposed to be. It's supposed to be purposeful. Unconditional love is the name of the game. I recently saw a sign that said, God is now here. G-O-D. I-S-N-O-W-H-E-R-E. There's so many people who would look at that and say, God is nowhere. I want you to look at it and know that God is now here. Not nowhere. True generosity never looks to reciprocity. It gives neither because it expects a gift in return, nor because there is a duty or obligation. It's rewarded by the joy of giving. That's Archbishop Fulton Sheen. It's not about your position. It's about your influence on your neighbor. And every man's neighbor is his looking glass. Thanks for choosing to journey with Judy this morning, and thank you to the Cunis Country Auto Group for sponsoring our show. You're listening to Lake 96.1. We'll be back. 'Cause I don't want to live like I don't care. I don't want to say another empty prayer. Oh, I refuse. So who's your neighbor? Everyone. My daughter Campbell just started to learn how to braid her hair 1,000,000,000 different ways. And she asked me last night if she could sit down and teach me how to French braid. She says, "You're the only mother who cannot braid." So I sat down and very patiently I tried to allow her to teach me how to French braid. The bottom line was, in her estimation, it was, quoting Campbell, an epic fail. This morning I said to her, "Cam, could I actually say now that I'm a French braider?" And her response was, "Absolutely not. You can now say that you have a concept of how to be one." And I said to her, "Baby, I'm using that in my show. Because here's why. I'm hoping that you're going to want to be and know that you get to be a good Samaritan. But by simply the virtue of listening to this show, you have not become one. You are simply someone who now can say you have the concept of how to be one." Stay tuned. Life Matters is next with Dave and Faith, not Nancy. And this week, keep it hot, honest, open, and transparent. Peace out.